sign, youngster. You'll have the house afire before the day's out. Tommy! Tommy!
Oh, that boy. I told him again and again to set off those crackers away from the house.
Oh, Essie, you can't expect a boy to remember. It's the 4th of July.
Tommy, you mind what your mother told you? You take the crackers out in the backyard. You hear me?
Oh, all right, Pop. What got into that boy? He did that on purpose to scare us.
Don't know what to call him, but he's mighty like a Roosevelt.
Did you crazy?
Boy,
I can tell you if he won't.
Off to the Rands, I suppose.
Hmm? I'm taking Elsie canoeing. And this evening I'm staying at the Rands for dinner.
How about you, Mid?
I'm going to the beach sand harbor.
Good. And, Sid, you're coming to the Sachem Club picnic with me, aren't you?
You bet. That is, if
Oh, I know what that darn Sachem Club picnic is always meant.
Oh, not this time, Essie. Sid's a reformed character since he's been on the paper at Waterbury. At least that's what he swore to me last night.
I'm pure as the driven snow, that's me. You're going to run me for president of the Women's Temperance League of America.
Sid, you're a caution, but you be careful now.
Oh, I know he'll be careful today, won't you, Sid?
No, I swear to you, Lily, if any man even offers me a drink, I'll kill him. That is, if he changes his mind.
It's no good talking to him, Lily. We just have to hope for the best.
Oh, now, you women, stop picking on Sid. It's the 4th of July. Even a downtrodden newspaper man has a right to enjoy himself on his holiday. Say, what do you say to an automobile ride, huh? Sure, we could drive around town, then down to the lighthouse and back. And Sid and I can drop you two off here. We go right on to the picnic.
That'll be nice.
Then afterwards, would you like to go to the fireworks display with me to the beach, Lily?
I'd like to, Sid.
Thanks, sir. Listen, Uncle Sid. Yes. Don't let me catch you and Aunt Lily spooning on a bench tonight. It'll be my duty to call a cop.
Arthur.
Now, that'll do you. Kicking a football around Yale seems to have blunted your sense of humor.
I guess I better beat it. Just got time to catch the 8:20 trolley.
All right, you run along, then. Have a good time.
Goodbye, all.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Where's Richard?
I bet he's off somewhere writing a poem to Muriel McConder. Silly.
He's up in his room reading.
He's always reading now. Not my idea of having a good time in vacation.
Matt, you really must speak to Richard about those awful books.
Oh, Essie.
No, you've got to give him a good talking to, really.
Now, look, I know there's nothing to it. Gosh, when I think of the books I used to sneak off and read when I was a kid. Well, I guess I might as well get him on the carpet. Richard! Richard!
All right, Mom, come in.
The youngster gets his nose in the book, the house could fall down. And...
you want me, Pa?
Well, I hoped I'd make that plain. Come on over, sit down a while.
Well, I didn't hear you. I was off in another world.
Oh. What were you planning to do with yourself today? You going to the beach with Mildred?
That silly skirt party? I should say not.
He's not coming because Muriel isn't. I bet he's got a date with her somewhere.
Well, shut up, Mid.
Now, that'll do you.
Mid, dear, hadn't you better be getting ready for the picnic?
Yes, Ma.
Well, son?
Well, I thought I'd just stay home, Pa, this morning anyway.
Oh, help Tommy set off his firecrackers?
I should say not. I don't believe in this silly celebrating the 4th of July. All this lying talk about liberty when there is no liberty.
Oh?
The land of the free and home of the brave. Home of the slave is what they ought to call it. The wage slave ground under the heel of the capitalist class. Oh, the 4th of July is a stupid cause. What would you do celebrate the 4th of July? I'll celebrate the day the people bring out the guillotine again, and I see Pierpont Morgan being driven by in a Tumbro.
Well, Richard, you know, I always know I have to listen to at least one stump speech every 4th. I hope that hearing yours lets me off for the rest of the day.
What's this book you've been reading?
Carlyle's French Revolution.
Oh, so that's where you got the Tumbro from and piled poor old Pierpont into it, huh? That's a darn fine book, Richard. I'm glad you're reading it.
What, have you read it?
Well, even a newspaper owner can't get away from reading a book every now and again.
Well, I didn't mean... Say, isn't it a great book, though, Pop?
Mm.
You know that part about Robespierre?
Yeah.
back.
Never you mind about Rovers, Pierre, young man. You march up to your room and you get those books you've hidden on the shelf in your wardrobe. Let your father see those.
Now, never mind us getting them now. We'll waste the whole afternoon on those darn books. And besides, he has a right to keep his library to himself. That is, if they're not too. What books are there, Richard?
Well, there's a book.
Well, I'll tell you, he won't. There's one by that awful Oscar Wilde that they flung in jail for heaven knows what wickedness. And then there's a book of poems by a Swin something.
What? Poems and ballads by Swinburne. Well, that's the greatest poet since Shelley.
Look,
he tells the truth about real love.
Love? Well, all I can say is from reading here and there that if he wasn't flung in jail along with Wilde, he should have been. Well, there were things in there that were so indecent, I couldn't even read them. And then there was a poem, a long one, The Ruby. What is it, Richard?
The Ruby out of Omar Khayyam. That's the best of all.
I've read that essay.
Why, Nat?
Why, sure, I've got a copy down at the office now. There are some very fine things in it, seems to me. Some true things.
Oh, Nat, I don't see how
you... it's wonderful, isn't it, Pa? Yeah. Hey, you remember this? A book of verses underneath the bough, a jug of wine, a loaf of bread... And now beside me, singing in the wilderness.
Hey, you know who's coming up the walk? Old man McComber.
Who, Dave?
Yeah.
Oh, what in the thunder is that old fool?
Lily, let's go upstairs and get our things on. And Nat, you get rid of him the first minute you can.
I can't imagine what he... I bet it's to complain about something.
Oh,
I know
that.
I wish I didn't have to be pleasant to the old buzzard. He's about the most valuable advertiser I've got.
I know. You give him the devil anyway, huh?
Hey, where are you off to?
Hi, Rum.
All right, you come right back down as soon as he's going to hear. I'm not through with you yet.
Yes, Pa.
Well, hello, Dave.
Good morning.
Well, come on over and sit down. Well, what good wind blows you around on this glorious fourth?
I regret to say it's something disagreeable. Disgraceful would be nearer the truth, and it concerns your son, Richard.
Oh, now, come now, Dave. I'm sure that Richard has...
And I'm positive he has. You're not accusing me of being a liar, I hope. I have proof of everything in his own handwriting.
All right, now, just what is it you're charging him with?
With being dissolute and blasphemous. With deliberately attempting to corrupt the morals of my young daughter, Muriel.
Well, then I'm afraid I'll have to call you a liar, Dave.
I thought you'd get around to that. So I brought the proofs with me. My wife discovered them in one of Muriel's bureau drawers, hidden under the underwear. Evidently, you've been too busy to take the right care about Richard's bringing up or what he's allowed to read. Well, I can't see why his mother failed in her duty.
Why, you darned old fool. Can't you see that Richard is only a fool kid? He's just at that age where he grabs onto everything radical to reading and has to pass it on to everyone to show everyone what a young hellion he is. Why, at heart, you'll find he's just as... innocent and as big a kid as your Muriel is. And if you think that this will corrupt your Muriel, you must believe she's easily corrupted.
Why?
And I think you'll find out she knows a lot more about life than you give her credit for and can guess that a stork didn't bring her down your chimney.
Now you're insulting my daughter.
I'm not insulting her. I'm giving her credit for ordinary good sense.
Well, I certainly never dreamed you'd have the impudence after reading those papers to claim your son was innocent of all wrongdoing.
Oh, no. Well, just what did you dream I'd do?
Take and give him a hiding he'd remember to the last day of his life.
Now, listen, Dave. I've stood just about all I can stand from you today. Now, you get out.
Now,
you get out first, unless you want to kick in the rear to help
me. Now, you're getting to lose your temper. I'm only demanding you do your duty by your own, as I have already done by mine. I'm punishing Muriel. She's not to be allowed out of the house for a month, and she's to be in bed every night by 8 sharp. Here's a letter from Muriel for your son. It makes clear, I think, how she's come to think about him now that her eyes have been opened. I hope he heeds what's inside of it, for his own good and yours. And don't think I'm not going to make you regret the insults you've heaped on me. I'm taking the advertisement for my store out of your paper.
Right, take it out.
And it won't go in again, I tell you, not unless you apologize in writing and promise to punish that.
Oh, I see you in hell first.
Good for you. You scared the pants off of him. He never seen you like that before.
Mm.
What's this?
The samples of the new freedom out of those books that Essie found that Richard's been passing on to Muriel to educate her. That's what started the whole rumpus.
Well, here's a warm Lulu for Bear. This, my life is bitter with thy love, thine eyes blind me, thy tresses burn me. Thy sharp sides divide my flesh and spirit with soft sound.
Well, I must have missed that one.
Yeah, it gets better. There. Get this. That from face to feet, thy lovely body were abolished and consumed. And in my flesh, thy very flesh, entombed.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I can imagine Dave's face when he digested that for the first time, huh? Yeah, it's no joking matter, though. That stuff's warm.
Yeah?
It's too darn warm, if you ask me.
Not the kind of thing to send to a decent girl. You think he's hanging around her just to see what he can get? You know, if that's true, he deserves that beating that old McComas and I should give him. Richard!
Yes, Bob?
Come on out here.
I'll beat it, huh? Good luck, Omar.
What, Pop?
Come here. Sit down. Now, listen, son. I'm going to ask you a question. I want an honest answer. I want to warn you beforehand that if the answer is yes, I'm going to punish you. And I'm going to punish you hard because you'll have done something that no boy of mine ought to. Now, I know that you've never lied to me before, and I don't believe, even to escape punishment, that you'd lie to me now, would you?
I won't lie, Pa.
All right. Have you been trying to have something to do with Muriel? Something you oughtn't? You know what I mean.
Oh, no. What do you think I am, Pa? I never would. She's not that kind. I love her. I'm going to marry her after I get out of college. We're engaged.
All right, that's all I wanted to know. We won't speak any more about it.
Well, I don't see how you could think I do it. Did that old idiot McComber say that about me?
Oh, now, you shouldn't call your future father-in-law names, should you? It ain't respectful. And you know, you can't completely blame old Dave when you run through that literature you've been passing on to his innocent daughter.
So that's why. We found those, did he? Well, I told her to be careful.
I'm afraid I got to agree with him, though. They hardly fit reading for an innocent girl. They're all right in their way for you, who are a man. But, you think it over. See if you don't agree with me.
Well, I only did it because I liked them. And I wanted her to face life as it is. She's so darn afraid of life, afraid of her old man. She's even afraid to let me kiss her. And I thought they'd give her the spunk to let her lead her own life and not always be thinking of being afraid.
Yeah, I see. Well, I'm afraid she's still afraid. Here's a letter from her that he said to give you. Better be prepared for a bit of a shock. Never mind, son. There's plenty of other fish in the sea. Well, darn it. I better warm up the Buick. We'll never get to that picnic.
The little coward. I hate her. She can't treat me like that. I'll show her.
Yeah, don't forget your goggles.
I won't.
We're about ready to start at last, thank goodness. Oh, I hope no more callers are on the way.
Richard, whatever's the matter with you? You look as if you'd lost your last friend.
Oh, I don't feel so well. My stomach's sick.
You poor boy. Oh, what a shame, and on the 4th of all days. Oh, maybe I ought to stay home with him if he's sick.
Yes, I'll stay too. Poor boy.
Oh, no, you go, Ma. I'm not really sick. I'll be all right. You go. I want to be alone. Oh, darn Tommy and his darn firecrackers. You can't get any peace in this house with that darn kid around. Darn the 4th of July anyway. I wish we still belonged to England.
Well, he can't be so very sick after that. I tell you, sometimes I can't make head or tail of him.
Come on, folks. Let's get started.
With them.
Oh, Walt, we can't
be home any time now.
Hey, Dick. Oh. Hello, Wint.
Hey, keep it quiet, kid. I don't want the folks to know I'm here. Look, tell Art I want to see him a second on a QT.
Oh, I can't. He's up at the Rands. Won't be back before 10 anyway.
Darn, I thought he'd be here for dinner.
Well, that blows things up for fair.
What is it, Wint?
I might tell you if you keep your face shut.
Well, I can.
Well, I ran into a couple of Swift babies from New Haven this afternoon. I dated them up for tonight, thinking I could catch Art. Now it's too late to get anybody else, and I'll have to pass it up. I'm nearly broke. I can't afford to blow them both to drinks.
Well, I got $11 saved up. I could loan you some.
Say, you're a good sport.
Next, kid, I don't want to borrow your money.
Say, have you got anything on for tonight?
No.
Want to come along with me? I'm not trying to lead you astray, you understand? I wouldn't ask you to come if I wasn't in a hole. If I didn't know you were coming down to Yale next year. It'll be a help if you'd just sit around with Belle. Feed her a few drinks. While I'm off with Edith. See what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
You ever been out with any girls? I mean real swift ones.
Oh, what do you think? Sure, I have.
Did you ever drink anything besides sodas?
Sure, lots of times. Beer, slow gin fizz, Manhattans.
Hey, you know more than I thought. Look, you can be back by 10:30 or 11:30. Can you fix it up so your folks won't get wise? Yeah. Ought to be easy on the 4th.
Oh, sure, don't worry about that.
Well, you'll be at the Pleasant Beach Inn at 9:30 then. Better come around back to the beer garden. And don't forget to grab some cloves to take the booze off your breath.
Oh, I know what to do.
See you later, then. So long.
Show her she can't treat me like that. I'll show her.
Tommy, come in now and wash up for dinner.
Yes, Ma.
Dick, Mom says come on in. We're going to eat. Gee, but I'm awful hungry, ain't you?
No, food. That's all you ever think of.
Tommy, don't forget about the fish. Well, I had to warn him not to give me away to Nat about the fish. He knows because I sent him to the market for it, and he's liable to burst out laughing.
About what?
Well, I never told you, but you know how Nat always carries on about not being able to eat bluefish.
Well, I know he says it poisons him.
Poisons him nothing. He's been eating bluefish for years. Only I tell him each time it's weak fish. We're having it tonight.
Missy, aren't you ashamed?
Not much, I'm not. I like bluefish.
Oh, that girl. Oh, she'll be the death of me. Nora's got the table all wrong. We'll have to reset it.
No. Now, Lily, you're always helping. It's not fair to ask you on your vacation. You need all the rest you can get after teaching a pack of wild Indians the kids all year.
Now, you know I love to help. It makes me feel I'm some use at this house instead of just sponging.
Sponging? You pay, don't you?
I don't know how you and Matt stand it, having a cranky old maid around all the time.
Oh, Lily Miller, I lose all patience with you when you go on like that. What time is it getting to be?
6:15.
Oh, dear, I hope those men folks aren't going to be late for dinner. But with that darn Sachem Club picnic, it's more likely than not. I see you got on your new dress.
Yes, I thought if Sid's taking me to the fireworks, I ought to spruce up a little.
You mustn't mind if Sid gets home a bit gay. I expect Matt to. We'll have to listen to all those old stories about when he was a boy.
Oh, I don't think Sid will this time. Not after his promise.
Well, I know, but men are weak. That was a good notion of Matt's getting that job for Sid on the Waterbury Standard. All Sid ever needed was to get out of the rut he was in here. He's making good money in Waterbury, too, $35 a week. He's in a better position to get married than he ever was before.
Well, I hope he finds a woman who's willing. But after he's through gambling on the horses and dice and playing Kelly Pool, there won't be much left for a wife, even if there was nothing else he'd spend his money on.
He'd give all that up for the right woman. Lily, why don't you change your mind and marry Sid and reform him? He loves you and he always has.
Never enough to stop drinking for. If he'd ever give me proof... Oh, but even then, I don't think I ever could. It's 16 years since I broke off our engagement. But what made me break it off is as clear to me now as it was then. He's taking up with bad women.
Oh, he always swore he was raped into that party.
Oh, it's no good talking, Elsie. What's done is done. But you know how much I like Sid in spite of everything. I know he was just born to be what he is, irresponsible. Don't talk to me about marrying him, because I just never could.
He's a dumb fool. A stupid dumb fool. That's all he is.
Oh,
he's almost alone,
Ma.
You've got a tapeworm, that's what I think.
No, Ra, you can bring in the soup now.
Oh, I'm afraid, Lily.
Yes, I might have known.
Ma! Ma! Uncle Sid, you mean whisper me and think I don't know Uncle Sid soused again.
You be quiet. You're getting too smart. You go over there and sit down. Not another word out of you. Now, sit down, everybody. Now, he'll be all right. We'll get him in here and we'll get some food in him. He'll be fine.
Come right in here. Don't stop to wash up or anything. Dinner's on the table.
All right, Essie. Well, here we are, Essie, right on the dot.
Matt, aren't you ashamed?
I couldn't resist it. I simply couldn't resist it. Well, it's nice to be home again. Oh, did we have fun today? Sid was the life of that picnic. You ought to heard him.
Sid, come in here.
Oh.
Start eating, everybody.
Essie, Sid is sort of embarrassed about... I'm afraid he's had just a little, you know. So don't pretend you understand. And don't you kids, either. And Lily, don't you, because he's scared of you.
Very well, Matt.
All right, Sid, close this corner.
It's good soup, Eddie.
Good soup.
Good evening. Beautiful evening. Never remember seeing a more beautiful sunset. Oh, no, I am sorry. Lily, I'm deeply sorry, huh?
That's all right.
Soup?
Of course it's soup. What'd you think it was? Hurry up and eat it.
All right. Soup be it. Your spoon, is that any way to treat a pal? Down with spoon. Lick. Your very good health, my ladies and gentlemen. Hmm? Well. Are you publicly upbraiding me in front of this? Isn't soup liquid? Aren't liquids drunk? As if I ever so far forgot myself as to drink a leg of lamb. Now, think of the wasted effort eating soup with spoons. There's 50 grueling lifts per plate. There's billions of soup eaters all over the world. It's shattering, isn't it? Nah.
Pass me your soup plates, everybody. We wait for that girl to come in. We'll be here all night.
Ah, what a sight for sore eyes, my beautiful Makushla.
Sure, Mr. Sid. You'll kiss the blinding storm and you've a drop taken.
My star eye in the morning.
Nora, put on that face.
Will you please sit down and stop making a fool of yourself?
This wouldn't be bluefish by any chance, would it, my dear?
Oh, of course not, ma'am. Sweet fish. We never have bluefish on account of union.
Yes, I regret to say that there's a peculiar oil in bluefish that invariably poisons me. Not much there. I fail to see what's so funny about my being poisoned.
Wait a minute. I suspect plot. Jim, I think this fish looks blue. Very blue. Look how guilty she looks. A veritable Lucretia boy. Matt, can it be this woman has been slowly poisoning you all these years? And how well you stood it.
Now give us a rest, you darn. Oh, the joke's a joke. Is this true, Essie?
Yes, it's true, if you must know.
And you never would have suspected if it hadn't been for that darn Tommy and Sid poking his nose in. You've been eating bluefish for years and thriving on it. And it's all a lot of nonsense about that peculiar oil.
Kindly allow me to know my own constitution. As a matter of fact, I've felt upset afterwards every damn time we've had fish. All right, I can't eat this.
All right, then, don't. There's plenty of lobster. You can fill up on that.
Well, you seem in a very merry mood tonight, Richie. I thought you were the original of the heart bowed down today.
Never mind. If you let them scoff, what do they know about girls whose hair sizzles, whose lips are fireworks, whose eyes are red-hot sparks?
Is that what you wrote to Muriel? You silly goat, you!
Shut up, Ned. What do I care about her? I'll show you all how much I care.
Eat plenty now, Nat. You get no tea or dessert after lobster, you know.
Mm. Gee, I love lobster.
Did you have a good time at the beach today, Mildred?
Oh, fine, thanks, Pa. The water was wonderful and warm.
Well, you swim far?
Yes, for me. But that's not so awful far.
Well, you ought to be a good swimmer if you take after me. You know, I was a regular water rat in my day. You know, I never go down to that beach, but I remember the time that Red Sisk and I went swimming. I saved his life.
Uh-oh.
What's that?
No, go right on swimming. Don't mind me.
Well, as I say, you see, Red dared me to race him to the one-mile buoy and back, and I said, all right, and so we started out. Well, we swam and we swam, and we were pretty evenly matched, but he was bigger and he was older than me. Finally, I began to draw ahead, see. And then all of a sudden, I hear a cry from behind me, sort of a gasp, like, you know, help, help. I turn around. Here's Red with his face all white and pinched, and he says to me sort of meekly, hey, Ned, help me. I get a cramp in my leg. Well, I don't mind telling you, I was mighty scared. And suddenly I thought, if I could pull him to the buoy, I could hold on to him till somebody noticed this, you see. But the buoy was still, well, I calculate about 200 feet away.
250.
What's that?
I say, I've measured the distance. Every time you've saved Red's life for 30 years, and the mean average to that buoy is 250 feet.
Well, I guess you're right, sir. I guess I have told that one too many times. Bored everybody. Guess I'm getting old, Mother. Getting to repeat myself. Why doesn't somebody tell me?
Oh, no such thing. You're just as young as you ever were to hear you tell it. And you eat your lobster. Maybe that'll keep your mouth shut.
Ma, look at him. He's eating that lobster shells and all.
I prefer shells. Oh, famous epicures prefer shells. Unless I eat the shells, there's a certain peculiar oil.
There's poison.
Am I right?
You should never have a good time kidding me. Go ahead, I don't mind.
Oh, he'd better go right up to bed for a while. That's what he'd better do.
I think I better go. There's one more duty to perform. No day is complete without Lily. Once and for all, will you marry me?
No, I won't. Never.
Well, probably just as well. Well, how could I forget the precepts I learned at my mother's dying knee? She said, dear Sidney, never marry a woman who drinks. The touch liquor should never touch thine.
Sid, you leave Lily alone and go to bed.
Yes, we will meet by and by. You want to be saved, brethren, in the sweet boom, boom, by and by, boom, boom, we will meet at a beautiful shore, boom, boom, watch and pray, boom, 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 boom,
boom, boom, boom, boom, boom, boom, boom, boom, boom, boom, boom, boom, boom, boom, boom, boom, boom, boom, boom, boom, boom, boom,
boom, boom, boom. My sides ache, I swear. We oughtn't to do it, you know. It only makes it encourages him. But
that's just it. You oughtn't. Even I laughed. It does encourage.
That's been his downfall. Everybody always laughing. Everybody saying what a card he is, what a caution. So funny. And he's gone on. We're all responsible, making it easy for him, and all we ever do is laugh.
Oh, now, Lily, now, don't take on so. It isn't as serious as all that.
Maybe it is to me. Or was. Once. I'm sorry, Matt. I'm sorry, Essie. I didn't mean... I'm not myself tonight. If you'll excuse me, I'll go into the front parlor and lie down on the sofa a while.
Of course, Lily.
Well, I never knew Lily to come right out with things like that. Anything special happen?
Not that I know. Except... Sid promised to take her to the fireworks tonight, and wild horses wouldn't drag her there now.
I thought she'd got all over that foolishness about him long ago.
She never will.
Well, she'd better. He's got fired out of that Waterbury job.
Oh, dear.
And he told me the day at the picnic when he got enough Dutch courage in him.
Isn't he the fool, though?
Do you know what I think? It's Aunt Lily's fault Uncle Sid's going to ruin. It's all because he loves her and she keeps him dangling after her and eggs him on and ruins his life. Like all women love to ruin men's lives. I don't blame him for drinking himself to death the way she's treated him. I'd do the same thing myself if I were in his boots.
Richard, you stop that talk.
Well, drink for you know not whence you come nor why. Drink for you know
now
not
listen
why.
Listen here, young man. I stood just about all your nonsense I can for today. Now you're growing a great deal too big for your size. You ask me. Now you just... Keep that darn fool talk to yourself. You understand? Or you're going to regret it.
I'm ashamed of you, Richard. That's what I am.
Oh, what do I care? I'll show you. I'll show you all. Well.
We return to our wilderness, coming to you with the compliments of the fine store where you buy Hallmark cards immediately after station identification.
Dave Garraway's in Paris on the Today Show tomorrow morning.